It is now my pleasure to introduce today's keynote speaker. Josh Linkner is the New York Times bestselling author of Disciplined Dreaming, a proven system to drive breakthrough creativity, named one of the top 10 business books of 2011. He is the CEO and managing partner of Detroit Venture Partners. By investing in startups, he and his partners, Magic Johnson and NBA team owner Dan Gilbert, are rebuilding troubled urban areas through entrepreneurial fire. Josh Linkner is the founder, chairman, and former CEO of ePrize, the largest interactive promotion agency in the world. He has advised 74 of the world's top 100 brands on their marketing strategy and has been recognized by President Barack Obama as a champion of change. Josh is the adjunct professor of applied creativity at the University of Michigan. He is also a Berkeley-trained professional jazz guitarist who has performed at the highest levels internationally. Most importantly, Josh is on a mission to make the world more creative. It is my pleasure to introduce to you the main keynote of this year's conference, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Josh Linkner.
So the more curious you are, the more creative you'll become. How do you do this? It's actually one of the simplest techniques of all. You just simply ask these three questions again and again and again. Why, what if, and why not? Because when you ask these questions, it forces you to challenge conventional wisdom. It forces you to imagine what can be instead of just what is. Next time someone comes to you with an idea, let's say it's a bad idea. Person comes up to you, hey, I got a terrible idea. They share your idea. Your instinct as a leader is to say, look, go back to your cube, terrible idea. The problem is you've just trained that person to never bring you another idea again. A more productive approach would simply be to respond without judgment and have a conversation. So you might say, tell me more about that idea. How did you come up with such an idea? Where do you see this idea going that could be even more powerful? Now, you don't want to lie and say it's a good idea. You're not going to pander to them. But if you can encourage a discussion, that person now feels validated and that they've had an opportunity to express themselves. Let's say they come to you with 9 bad ideas in a row. So what? Because the 10th idea could be the gem that you've been waiting for, the one that's transformational to your organization that ordinarily would have never surfaced had you just kept pushing those ideas down. We teach this, yet we reward that. We're taught in school to follow the rules, guess what the teacher knows, there's only one right answer, and whatever you do, don't make any mistakes. But if you run that game plan in the real world, if you run that game plan while leading your own libraries, it's a surefire path to mediocrity. Doing exactly the opposite is what allows us all to leave our biggest impact on the world. So when you think about killing creativity and feeding the fear, the opposite, of course, liberates us. WD-40, which I'm sure we all know, but I don't know if you know what it stands for. The name is actually stands for Water Displacement 40th Experiment. Could have easily been WD-31. But the cool part about this team is that they realize that more often than not, innovation and creativity doesn't happen as a giant lightning bolt that hits us in our sleep. It happens through a series of setbacks and failures and experiments that ultimately lead to something great. What the team at WD-40 knows, and what we all need to embrace, is that mistakes are not fatal. Mistakes are simply the portals of discovery. There's an old saying that every bullseye is the result of 100 misses. But why don't we teach our kids that? And why don't we run our companies that way? A couple fun things I'll share with you from the research that I did on the book. One of the companies that I interviewed issues a Failure of the Year award each year. So they hold a big banquet, and they celebrate the team member of the year and the project of the year and the failure of the year. So this goes for the team or individual that had a great idea. The numbers made sense. They went for it. Didn't work out at all. But good for them. So instead of punishing this, they celebrate failure. Think about the message that drives deep into the DNA of this company. Another company that I interviewed issues every team member 2 corporate get-out-of-jail-free cards each year. Here's what they say. They say, go out on a limb, be creative, and if you really screw something up, hand us one of these cards and you're off the hook, no questions asked. On the annual reviews, a team leader will actually be disappointed with a team member if they haven't used both of them. So you say, all right, is that risky? Well, perhaps, but what's the risk of not doing something like this? Irrelevance? Mediocrity? Getting passed by? So many people, so many organizations live their lives trying to play it safe, only to discover that playing it safe has become the riskiest move of all. Third way for all of us big shot business folks to hunt and kill our entrepreneurs is to embrace bureaucracy. That poisonous, vile spewing, insidious force that robs us all of our creative mojo. How do you do that? You think small. That's the anecdote, is to think small. Now, I don't mean think small ideas. I know that all of us in this room are thinking big, giant, game-changing ideas. But what I mean is, I mean think like a startup. Because startups change things, and startups shake up the status quo. Now, by the way, you don't have to be small to think small. I'll give you an example. A company called ITW. It's a manufacturing firm, 90-plus years of business, $16 billion in revenue. Not exactly a startup. But they think small. Because every time a business unit at ITW reaches $200 million in revenue, they splice it in half. And their theory is that they'd rather have several little $100 million scrappy business units that are nimble and aggressive and creative than one giant big bureaucratic swamp. Think about the difference between small company thinking and big company thinking. Small companies embrace risk, while big companies tend to avoid it. It's the difference between being urgent and slow moving, creating new ideas versus protecting the old ones. In small companies, ideas bottom up. They come from everywhere. With big company thinking, they're jammed only from the top down. It's the difference between being ideas-centric versus rules-centric, nimble versus bureaucratic, and having a fire in the belly sense of urgency versus becoming complacent. Take a quick look at this picture and imagine that it's a snapshot from a movie. So something's happening, something's leading up to it, something's about to happen next. And maybe just look at it, not too long, just 5 seconds, raise your hand and let me know what could be going on in this movie. Yes? She's reporting an accident of some kind. Excellent. What's another idea? Yes? She's about to become an accident. So true. Yes, right here. Ooh, someone's following her. Maybe it's like a suspense thriller kind of movie. I like it. Yes?
She's actually supposed to be watching someone else. She's a spy and they're getting away.
Oh, she's a spy. The other folks are getting away. Maybe she's calling in for some backup. I like it. That's a really good one. Yes?
She's calling her girlfriend to report a really hot cop.
Now we're going somewhere. I'm not sure the rating of this film yet. What's one more? Yes, right in the back. Wow, a horror-ish type film in which she closed a window on her dog. Yikes. See, I thought you were going to say she was yelling at her kids in the back seat, but yours is much more imaginative. So here's the question. How did you know all that? You were able to make it up. And the reason that this exercise is so easy for us all is that there are no rules, there's no wrong answers, there's no fear of retribution. So your mind becomes alive. Even those folks that walked into this room, arms folded, grumpy, oh, I'm not a creative type. Even if you didn't share something, I know you were thinking it, because that's the way the mind works.
In 1948, Polaroid launched this instant film. And it was a roaring success, and it was fantastic, and we all have childhood memories of using our Polaroid cameras. The problem is that while they started and they became on the map through creativity, they ultimately became immersed in protecting the golden goose instead of forging ahead. And they would say things like, well, we can't cannibalize our core business. Of course, we all know they ended up filing for bankruptcy protection, and you can no longer buy Polaroid film. I'd like to challenge you, if you ever hear the word cannibalize, to treat it in a different way. As brand marketers, we often say, oh, we can't cannibalize our product, or we can't cannibalize our market position. But I'd like to suggest that none of us are so all-powerful that we can control the market. So what's going to happen is that if you don't cannibalize it, somebody else is going to. I would encourage you to be the cannibal. There's a great quote by author Gary Hamel that said, right now, there's an entrepreneur out there forging a bullet with your company's name on it. Your only choice is to shoot first. We must out-innovate the innovators. At the company I built, ePrize, and I mentioned earlier, we just had the largest exit, I believe, in software in the state's history. So today we're about $100 million and about 500 employees. But over our 13-year journey, I was very worried that we would become entrenched with tradition. Traditions are great in families. Traditions are great at economic club lunches. Traditions are scary in the business world. Because the minute you start saluting the flag of the past, you're not embracing the changes of the day. Today, we live in a world of change like none other in history. So if we're not forging ahead, we run a significant risk. So anyway, here's how we combated that. We had a funny little fable that we stumbled upon that we told again and again and truly became part of our culture. So there's a 10-year-old girl, and she's making meatloaf in the kitchen with her mom. Like they've done every time before they put it in the oven, they cut both ends off the meatloaf. Well, that little girl gets curious. She says, Mom, why do we cut the ends off the meatloaf? Gee, honey, I don't know. That's the way I've always done it. That's the way my mom taught me. Let's call Grandma and ask. So they get on the phone, they call Grandma. Hey, Grandma, we're making meatloaf. We're cutting the ends off before we put it in the oven. Why do we do that? Grandma laughs. I don't know either. That's the way I've always done it. That's the way my mom taught me. Let's call great-grandma and ask. So the little girl, the mom, and the grandma get on a conference call, and they call great-grandma. Great-grandma, we're making meatloaf in the kitchen. We're cutting the ends off before we put it in the oven. Why do we do it? Well, great-grandmother laughs hysterically. She says, I have no idea why you're doing it. I used to do it because I didn't have a big enough pan. So we took that fun little fable and ran with it. And we identified something at our company, at ePrize, called a meatloaf. And a meatloaf was a system or a process or a way of doing business that maybe made all the sense in the world in the past, but today was either irrelevant or there was a better way. It forced us to be obsessed with always finding a better way to how we do our business, big and small. We never became entrenched. If any of you guys say, that's just the way our company works. That's just the way we do it. That's just the way things are done in our industry. Those are very scary. Those are fighting words. Because you're inviting competition from a more innovative startup that's got the potential to come eat your lunch. Why don't we feel creative? There's a couple big blockers. And if we can understand them, it'll help us conquer them and begin to unleash our own creative capacity. The first one is labeling. For some reason in our society, we attribute job title with levels of creativity. We think musicians are creative and statisticians are not. Meanwhile, there are professional musicians in symphony orchestras, and they play the notes on the page beautifully. They're not creating much of anything, though. They're wonderful technicians, perhaps not all that creative. On the other hand, we've seen how creative accountants can get. All kidding aside, no matter what your job title is, your level of creativity is something that we all share, and it's a muscle that we can all build. The biggest blocker of all, though, is fear. Fear is that insidious force that robs us of our creative juices. And you've all done it. I've done it. You're in a meeting and you have a great idea. But instead of sharing it, you hold it back. You talk yourself out of it, don't you? You say, well, what will my boss think? Or if it was such a good idea, someone else probably would have already said it. What if my idea doesn't work? Will I look foolish? I better just keep my mouth shut. The problem is, if we're building cultures that support fear like that, we're not only robbing individuals the gift of being able to leave their fingerprints on the world, but we're robbing our own organizations of their true potential. Now, I was thinking one day about greatness. And this was a few years ago as I was building my company. And I realized that greatness is often achieved in the face of adversity. You know, what would Superman be without Lex Luthor? You have great sports rivalries and political rivalries. Well, in our company, we had got out of the chute so quickly. And a few years in, we were the dominant player in our field. And we were so far ahead of the competitive set that we didn't have a big evil enemy to go after. So here's what I did. I invented one. So I rolled out to our company our fictitious nemesis, our made-up bad guys, the Slither Corporation. And I announced to our team, and this wasn't, by the way, to make us feel better. It was to challenge us. So I said, folks, there's a company out there that's bigger than us, and they're faster than us, and they're more profitable than us, and they're more innovative than we are. Slither. And this went on to become part of our culture because we made up the imaginary ultimate competitor. And we would do fun things. We would intercept memos, our spies inside Slither, and find out what they're doing. We'd get Wall Street Journal clippings of their earnings report. And we had a lot of fun with it. But I'll tell you what it did is it challenged us to go that extra step in our creative thinking. We mentioned earlier that fear is such a huge blocker of creativity and often can get in the way of us executing great ideas. So what we did at our company is we asked the question differently. I'll give you an example. If I said, all right, how can we shave 2 days out of our cycle time? People would clam up because they don't want to offend the person who put that process in place at first. So we stopped asking the question that way. Here's what we would say. Our spies just got an internal report, and we heard that Slither shaved 2 days out of their cycle time. How do you think they did it? Well, what happened was that the whiteboards became filled with ideas. Because there was no personal threat, it was a third party, so people could really express themselves. Now, I know most of us have real competitors, but I'd like to challenge you to think about something. What if someone down the block from you opened up a brand new company, and you had a crystal ball, and you realized that 5 years from now, they would be eating your lunch? Whether you represent a big brand or a small company, they would be putting you out of business. What would they do differently? How would they approach their work if they had a blank sheet? I'll tell you, someday a company, no matter how big you are, someday a company is going to come along and put you out of business. It might as well be you. So many companies and so many industries follow this Me Too pattern. Oh, that's what my competitors are doing. I'm just going to do pretty much the same thing. But we got to stop that. We got to stop it here in Michigan. We don't want to be the Silicon Valley of the Midwest or the New York of the Midwest. We want to be the Michigan of Michigan. Let's stop apologizing for what we're not and start celebrating what we are. The world doesn't need another Me Too player. The world doesn't need another Me Too anything. What the world craves and will pay handsomely for is originality and new ideas and fresh thinking. We have an abundance of that in Michigan. Let's start celebrating it instead of repressing it. The point I want to drill home is it wasn't because they did what everyone else was doing. It was because they saw a flock and sprinted in the opposite direction. That type of oppositional thinking can help not only the folks that come visit you, but can help you reimagine what your library can be and how you can best serve your community. I just wanted to wrap up with one example that kind of brings all this home. And when I say bring it home, it's really personal for me because my hometown is Detroit, Michigan.
Go Tigers!
Go Tigers! I think we may have some opposing views, but that's okay. But I'll tell you, from a brand standpoint, how could you have a worse brand to represent than Detroit? So we've been the punching bag of the media for the last decade. And in cover of Time magazine saying, you know, Detroit should be sold for scrap. Well, it's interesting to me, though, because 100 years ago, Detroit was the Silicon Valley of our country. This is where entrepreneurs came to build their fortunes and to invent things. And we became very inventive, and we were prosperous, and we built beautiful buildings and hospitals, etc. But over the last several decades, we stopped innovating, and frankly, we stopped winning. And our city was spinning with hopelessness and despair. Well, recently, there's a whole new vibe happening in Detroit. In our case, we're investing in startups to try to rebuild Detroit through entrepreneurial fire. And our thinking is that by backing passionate entrepreneurs, we'll be able to create jobs, urban density, and hope. So despite all my enthusiasm, most people still think of Detroit as Murder City, and a terrible place to be. So how do you change that as a brand marketer? How do you take an image that's so tarnished and tell a different story? Well, one brand did exactly that. Many of you have seen this, but they launched a TV spot on the Super Bowl. And literally, I'll tell you, this one TV spot changed the story of Detroit on an international basis. As a tech entrepreneur, I would travel around, and people would say to me, "What are you doing in Detroit?" And now you know what I hear? "Oh man, you're from Detroit. How cool. I hear what's happening there." One ad, one injection of creativity made all the difference in the world. Let's check it out. I get chills every time I see it.
"I got a question for you. What does this city know about luxury? Huh? What does a town that's been to hell and back know about the finer things in life? Well, I'll tell you, more than most. You see, it's the hottest fires that make the hardest steel. Add hard work and conviction, and the know-how that runs generations deep in every last one of us. That's who we are. That's our story. Now, it's probably not the one you've been reading in papers, the one being written by folks who've never even been here and don't know what we're capable of. Because when it comes to luxury, it's as much about where it's from as who it's for. Now, we're from America, but this isn't New York City, or the Windy City, or Sin City, and we're certainly no one's Emerald City.
City, and this is what we do.
I want to encourage you, as we leave here today and you go back to your offices, now is the time. Now is the time to unleash our creative capacity. Now is the time to stick our fingers in the eye of those complacent incumbents. Now is the time to let our imagination soar. And by doing so, it's the time for us to seize the enormous opportunity that's waiting for all of us just outside those doors. Thank you very much.